Good evening. It is my great privilege as Scientific Director of the UBS International Center of Economics and Society to welcome you all today at today's lecture on innovation, creative destruction, and the smart state. My first welcome is, of course, due to tonight's speaker, Philippe Aghion. It is an immense honor and pleasure to have you here and to introduce you as the speaker of this event. I would also like to welcome the various representatives from the state, the canton, and the university, as well as the many leaders from the business world and academia who join us today. Philippe Aghion is a world-leading economist whose influence extends well beyond academic circles. Since 2002, he holds the prestigious Robert Wagner Professorship of Economics at Harvard University. As you can see, oops, you cannot see it. As you can see now in the slide, Philippe has crossed a few times the ocean. He started in the United States, he has been in Europe, now he's in the United States. Some of us hope that he will soon cross the ocean again. He has received numerous prizes and awards and has delivered several prestigious invited lectures. Let me only mention the 2001 Yuri Janson Medal as the best economist in Europe under the age of 45 and the more recent 2009 John von Neumann Award. Philippe Aghion is a frontier economist who lives through the principle of his own theories. One of his main ideas is that the set of successful economic policies and institutions depends on the distance from the technology frontier. A building block of the theory is that less advanced economies and firms imitate and adopt technologies that are already in use from other firms, while more productive firms and economies endeavor to move the world technology frontier, as do many Swiss firms. As a researcher, Philippe acts like the more productive firms in his theory. Namely, he pushes the knowledge frontier rather than adapt and elaborate existing theories. Another core message of his research, something that he will certainly touch upon today, is that governments and institutions are key factors in providing legal, economic, and political conditions conducive to innovation and growth. Coherent with this principle, he has actively engaged himself in policy advising, both at the French and at the European level. Philippe Aghion is not only a leading macroeconomist, he is also a path-breaking microeconomics theorist. His joint work with Matthias Vatripoint and Jean Tirole, and also Patrick Bolton, here you have a sample, is a pillar of the contemporary theory of firm. However, his most influential work is in the area of economic growth. His Econometrica 1992 paper, A Model of Growth Through Creative Destruction, is the milestone of the new Schumpeterian theory that has changed our understanding of innovation as the engine of economic growth. This article has attracted as many as 7,000 citations. Its contribution is worth a Nobel Prize award in economics that many of us regard as overdue. Philippe has later moved to the junction between long-run growth and economic development. This includes our joint work on distance to frontier selection and growth, and our ensuing empirical study on the effect of liberalization reforms in India. Philippe has also pioneered with various co-authors, Daron Semoglu, Leonardo Burstein, and David Hemus, the study of the relationship between the governance of the innovation process and the risk of a global environmental disaster. This is an area where the coordinated action of smart governments is mostly urgently needed. Finally, he is the author of important textbooks, which have trained several generations of young scholars. His impressive endogenous growth theory, published in 1998, has been a reference for years. Well, at least before, in 2009, he decided to write another textbook, The Economics of Growth. However, the process of Schumpeterian creative destruction continues, and Philippe is already working on a new textbook. Philippe Aghion was my teacher in graduate school at the London School of Economics. Like for many others, he was a great source of inspiration. I remember distinctively the day in which he came to the lecture having forgotten his notes in another city. In spite of being an expert of organization theory, Philippe's best quality is not, I dare say, self-organization. We experienced this no later than yesterday night, when we had to run through Zurich to get back Philippe's computer with today's lecture, which he had forgotten in the restaurant. But going back to London, when others would have excused themselves and canceled the lecture, he went on and delivered what turned out to be, if not the clearest, certainly one of the most intriguing and fascinating lectures I remember. That was a turning point in my decision to start doing my own research on economic growth. I'm sure today Philippe has not forgotten his notes. I've taken good care of that. And since I imagine that you look forward to listening to his lectures, ladies and gentlemen, I give you Philippe Aghion from Harvard University. Philippe, the floor is yours.
I don't know what to say. I mean, Fabrizio has been way too generous. He's comments on me, and I feel, I'm blushing. I'm extremely moved to be here. I was saying earlier in the afternoon how impressed I've been by, the building up of economics in Zurich and how Zurich is becoming now more an unavoidable place, center in graduate education and research in economics in Europe and worldwide, and I see you see that kind of in real time, and it's extremely impressive, and I congratulate Fabrizio, Ernst, and those who are all those who contribute to this emergence of Zurich as becoming unavoidable a place for graduate studies and education and research. So today I was asked to talk about innovation and the role of the state. So I'm sure I will make a lot of statements. So I start being reasonable, and then as I move on, I start, undressing and then becoming increasingly more unreasonable and things. So it starts kind of okay. By the way, Fabrizio forgot to tell you that I also forgot my tie, and this tie was lent to me by the. I thought I had prepared my tie from Paris, and it was so well placed. Except I forgot it also in the hotel room this morning. But that's why for the first time I deliver a lecture with a very nice tie. Usually mine are very ugly. And once I tried to propose it to a taxi driver because I had forgotten my wallet and my jacket at a friend's place. And I tried to trade my tie. And he asked me to leave the car right away because he felt horribly insulted that I was giving my tie. He would not have with this one. Anyway, that's the... Okay, so let me start with the... with the thing. Okay, so we talk about growth, innovation, and the smart state. So, in fact, during the post-war period, Europe was growing faster than the. If you look at between 1945 and 1970, and the late 70s, Europe, the EU and Switzerland, but Europe, Western Europe, is growing faster. I'm already taking out some. I have to be careful. Yes, I can. I can do that. Would grow faster and would have lower unemployment than the US. So we are doing. We look doing better than the US, but in fact, it's because we are catching up with the US. And then you see that as of the late 70s, the Western Europe stops growing faster than the US. And then starting in 1995 until the crisis, until US growth have a higher rate of productivity growth than Western Europe. And that became a source of concern for the Europeans. And they said, what's going on there? And the first thing is that they said, maybe it's because we don't invest enough in R&D. And that was the Lisbon agenda. And they said, we should invest more in R&D. They thought there was something called a magic powder called R&D subsidies. And you take R&D subsidies and suddenly, all the flowers bloom like this, you see what I mean? And we didn't have enough of it. We should do more. So that was a kind of first phase. And they started started the magic powder, but it didn't work very well, but nothing happened. So then they start saying, well, maybe something else happened. We have to understand why we were doing so well and why we stopped doing so well. And it became, and the work that Fabrizio mentioned that we've done together gave a clue to the problem, is that in fact the growth in the European countries had been driven largely by imitation. We were essentially imitating, you know, more advanced technologies. And when you're in the business of imitations, there are certain kind of policies or institutions that are good. For example, the old welfare state. So the old welfare state, for example, the French state during the Trente Glorieuses, which were the 30 years after World War II, you had essentially three pillars. I'm being filmed. I would love to be able to dance from here to here, but I'm supposed to remain in this area there. Yeah. But I have to do it virtually. So close my eyes and imagine that you are flying on the roof. So the French state over the Trente Glorieuses had kind of three features. One was industrial policy. You would have the state, you know, having, relying on state-owned companies. You have very strong state-owned companies. A number of companies had been nationalized in France after World War II. But you also had private companies like Dassault, for example, that were private, but still very much held by the central government. So we had a very much what we would call Colbertist, industrial policy based on national champions plus state-owned firms. So that was the industrial policy part. Then you had the macroeconomic part. And this was a Keynesian policy, but you know the kind of Keynesian, you know, whenever you have a recession, you spend everywhere. The idea is that, you know, then people, you employ people, even, digging holes that are then, you employ other people to fill up the holes, you know, and that, you know, they spend the salaries, they buy stuff that create a demand for enterprises, and that pushes the machine. That's really the old Keynesian view. So whenever you have a recession, just spend in doing nothing, on doing anything, you know, that will solve your problem. Of course, you generate public deficit, and that's why you want to have taxation, because taxation will be a way to, of course, reduce the public debt that you generate by doing this, okay? So that was the macroeconomic policy over the business cycle, driven by demand and consumption, okay? And then you had the welfare state, but at the time, unemployment was very low. You see, because people were working in the same sector, I would say in the same firm. I've seen the same, you know, assistant in the same, during their whole career from there. I had a French teacher, I was a teacher from 20 to age the retirement in the same class, in the same place. You could have your whole life in the same firm. And there, the main issue for the state was to complete, in French, we would say, compléter les petits salaires. So you had people who were earning not enough to, and what you would do is to give them some subsidy, like allocation familiale, family subsidies, or subsidies for various things, to complete the small salary. And the social policy of the government was essentially a policy of completing. It was not to deal with unemployment, which was a non-issue at the time. We weren't even bringing people from other countries, but it was more, you know, to deal with the self. And that was the welfare state, essentially. So, you know, it had variants, but more or less, it was similar in other places, okay? And that welfare state worked very well during the Trente Glorieuses, but now the problem is that, you know, I will argue in this lecture that it's not only the economic policy at large that you need to change, but you also need to change the state, okay? So we will discuss here the change in policy that is called by the need to move to innovation-based economy, but also the way to organize the state has to change, okay? So that's what we're all about, okay? So when innovation becomes a driving force of growth, it calls for a new role of the state. So why do you need a new, why when you need for, so the view is that to say, well, we were good, I cannot go there, I have to stop there. Where is the limit? Can I, with a piece of chalk, no? Where can I stop? Can I go there? Can somebody say, no, stop there? No, I have to be there, really. Huh? That's, God, it's confined. Yeah, huh? I can go there a bit? Yeah, I want to be closer to you, you know. I want to be, yeah. So the thing is that, you know, why is it that this welfare state that I described is no longer adapted for the need of innovation-based economy? So the view we had with Fabrizio is that when you are catching up, you can rely on imitation. But as you make more and more frontier yourself, It's really innovation that will boost you, because imitating someone who is almost just a little bit better than me will give me very little. If I really want to do something, I need to innovate, you see? And by the way, there is another reason, is that globalization introduced new imitators. Now other people do the job of imitating, in particular in Asia. And they do that, you know, very well, with very low-cost labor. And so we are forced to innovate. So given that we are forced to innovate, why is it that the welfare state, the way I described it, is no longer suited? It's because, you see, frontier innovation involves what we call creative destruction. It's about new firms replacing old firms. It's about trial and errors. And it's all the time, and when you have a frontier innovator, the turnover is much higher. You have new activities replacing old activities, new firms replacing old firms. When you have an economy like this, you see, to have an industrial policy where you select champions makes no sense, because the champions change all the time. So you cannot have industrial policy that way. And besides, you need competition. If you have the kind of choosing the champion, you go against competition. You bias the game of entry and exit. So that's not good. You cannot no longer have this old industrial policy. And that's what people have recognized. You know, Anne Kruger and others have criticized industrial policy, and they were right to criticize it, because at least for developed countries, the old industrial policy is no longer suited. Now I talk about I will talk more in the lecture about the macroeconomic policy. Can you just have a macroeconomic policy through demand? No, because you see, in France, for example, in 1981, when Mitterrand came, we said let's boost demand. What did people do? They bought German magnetoscope or Japanese magnetoscope. You see what I mean? So all what it did was to deteriorate the trade balance, because of course people, they buy goods which are from where they want. We are open economy, and so you cannot just say I boost demand. What's important is to make sure also that your firms are competitive. So you need to become more supply side. So you cannot just say, I manage the cycle through demand. You have to manage the cycle in a way that allows firms to innovate over the cycle. And I will get back to that. You need to be much more supply side in the way to manage the business cycle. So you go against the old-fashioned way to manage the business cycle. And then talking about the social policy, do you have to change? Because now we turn over with entry and exit, you generate unemployment. You see, whenever you change activities, you need to dismiss workers or employees very often, and then they need time to find a new employment. So the fact that you have turnover plus the frictions that you have on the labor market together means that more growth through innovation means a higher rate of unemployment, and you need to accompany the process of retraining the workers so that they can rebound from one job to another job, from one sector to another sector. And there you have to organize things differently. So the role of the state is very important there to make sure that the training happens. Okay? So already you see that, you know, this calls for a new role of the state. Now, what I want to say is that, so that's the Schumpeterian growth theory, long-run growth driven by innovation, innovation result from entrepreneurial activities, and there is creative destruction, new innovation displaced old technologies. Okay? As I said, innovation requires flexibility, turnover, and different policies and institutions from imitation. So this will have an implication. The first part, I will show you in more detail what are the policies that you need for innovation. Okay? Why are they different from the policies that you need for imitation? And then I will go back to the role of the state in more details. But before I do that, I would like to just put already a debate for you on the state, and then we'll get back to that debate. The debate on the welfare state is as follows. There are those first who believe that the old welfare state still is there. You believe that this doesn't exist, that crazy people like this don't exist. Come to France. Come to France, discover the craziness of French politics. Talk to the left of the Socialist Party, talk to the left within the Socialist Party, the left of the, or talk to whatever, talk to various forces, even on both ends of the spectrum. There are some people who believe you can still have the old welfare state, okay? So those are des illuminés, but there are many illuminés in France who believe that, okay? You can keep the old welfare state, okay? The denial, huh? So you have that category. But then you have two, among those who acknowledge that you have to go move beyond the old welfare state, there are two kinds of people, and that's a big debate that you have in the US, in the UK, everywhere. There are those who say you should go for minimal state. The state should just withdraw. You go to innovation-based economy, the state should just do one thing, law and order. And the rest should all be private. Okay, that's one view. That's the Tea Party in the US. That, I don't know if where Cameron lies in the UK, but some people do, I don't know, I don't want to go into the detail, but we know that in various countries, and we have people in France, Madeleine and others, who are ultra-liberal, we say ultra, they think that the state should just withdraw from everything. You see, just let everybody, just law and order, have policemen, and that's it, you see what I mean? And the rest, we are out. Well, that's the tasers, you know, right? And then the rest, you're out. So that's one view. Hmm? But you could say, maybe they are right, you know, the innovation, turnover, the private sector should take over. There is another view that I will try to push. Is it no? We want neither the old welfare state, nor the minimal state. We want the smart state, and that's the theme of the lecture. We want a state that is conducive to the innovation. And we will try to look first, what do you need for innovation? And then we will move to say, okay, given that, why do you need a state there? And what should it be doing? And that's what I will talk about. That's what this lecture is about, okay? So let me first look at what do you need to enhance innovation and productivity growth in advanced countries. So I will argue that those are key elements, okay? You need higher education, and I will show you more detail, okay? Because, and in fact, you can already see, you know, why higher education is important. Here, voilà, here, Zurich, a big university. It's important to have Zurich be a top university because we know that Silicon Valley is near Stanford, Route 128 is near Harvard MIT. You know that, you know, you need a top graduate education if you want to be frontier innovator, okay? So that, we will get to that in more detail. You want competition, so you have to liberalize product markets. You want a more flexible labor market. I mentioned that already. But there are other things you want. You want, for example, the financial system organized differently. If you are in the business of imitating, I will argue, bank finance is okay, and subsidies from government. But if you are in the business of frontier innovation, we are people that are called, you know, venture capitalists, business angels, institutional investors. When you pronounce in France the word institutional investor, it's like if you say a bad word. You say it's like, I don't want to pronounce any bad word in French here. I mean, I don't want to do that, no. And then you have this counter-cyclical macroeconomic policy, which is this new way of managing the cycle. Those are at least things, I'm not being exhaustive, but those are things that you want to do differently. Let me go to them in more detail, okay? And then I will talk about the role of the state. So competition entry is more growth enhancing for countries or sectors that are closer to the technological frontier. And that's the picture I always show. I showed it already once. It's a picture, but you can do that in various ways. We have another picture with Fabrizio that I could show next, but I felt a bit bad that, you know, Fabrizio introduces all the great thing that Philippe has done, and you know, and then Philippe would show the figure done by Fabrizio. That all that would be a bit. So this one, that's what you have on the horizontal axis is entry rate, foreign entry rate. So it's a measure of competition on the UK market, okay? And what you have on the vertical is the productivity growth of existing firms. So the idea is that, but I could put innovation rate as well. So it's how the innovation and productivity growth reacts of existing firms, reacts to the fact of having more entry threat from foreign firms, okay? And you see, you have the red line and the blue line. What is different between them? The red line are firms that are the laggards, that are firms in their corresponding sector. They are not frontier. They are significantly below frontier. The blue firms are firms that in their sector are very close to the frontier. And you see that the blue and the red react very differently. When you are at the frontier, and I put more competition to you, you say, God, I will do better to beat the entrant. And I can do it because I'm already very good, and I know the local market. If it's like in a classroom, suppose you are very good in a classroom and I bring competition from new very good pupils. If you are a good guy in the classroom, you say, God, I will work harder and I will beat the new guy. But if you are un cancre, as we say in French, you know, cancre means that you are really at the bottom of the class near the central heating, we used to say. There, you know, you say, God, already I was not working very hard, but if you bring an entrant, I will work even less because anyway, I have no chance. I have no chance to do, you know, and I will do that. So you have these two forces, you know. When you are a developing country, you have many red firms and very few blue firms. When you are an advanced economy, you have many blue firms and few red firms. So the more advanced you are, the more growth-enhancing competition is, because the more it is this idea that you escape competition by innovating force that plays around, whereas the discouragement effect plays more if you are more backward. Okay, so that explains why competition is better. So that's the first reason. There is another reason why competition is very important, is that typically new innovators replace existing firms. If you prevent entry, it means that you are in a world where incumbents can just prevent entrants from coming. And that's bad in itself. You see, it's not just you want that competition is good because it induces incumbents to do more. It's also good because it allows better people to come in. And that's another reason. Okay, which is maybe, and those two reasons go together to tell you that competition becomes very important. And now, and the thing is that, you see, that's all the debate on industrial policy, because you see, we'll go to that. Of course, you know what, in Brussels, we may have a debate on competition policy in Brussels, but when they say, you know, we should have very tough competition policy. Joachim Almunia, you know, competition policy. And in the name of what I just said, he would say, let's avoid any kind of industrial policy. So we'll see that there are fallacies. If you go all the way to competition, you might think, well, it may imply certain things, and I will get back to these debates. Okay, but that's a kind of fact about competition. That was the graph that we had with Fabrizio. The left-hand side, so you see there on the horizontal axis, you have how advanced the country is, GDP of the country relative to US GDP, that was done by Fabrizio. When you are to the right, you are very advanced. When you are to the left, you are not advanced. And we divide the countries between those with low entry barriers, with high competition, and the left-hand side with high entry barriers. And what you see is that when you are far from frontier, it doesn't make much of a difference whether you have low barrier or high barrier. But when you are close to the frontier, the growth rate is much higher when you have low barriers than when you have high barriers. So when the closer to frontier you are, the more important for growth it becomes to have lower barriers, okay? So that goes in the same direction as the previous graph that I showed, okay? So, but now there are three policies. Just bear in mind about policy debates, but I don't want to enter that. Once you recognize I'm a competition guy, okay, now you might think, well, if you believe in competition, you don't believe in patents. So, for example, we have colleagues, Baldwin and Levin. I love in economics controversies. I teach always to my students, when there is no controversy in economics, you fall asleep. I mean, me, I have big problems. Maybe they take steel knox when I take the plane. I need controversies to keep awake. So controversy is a good way to stay awake. So Baldwin and Levin are fantastic, but they come with a very provocative idea, which is to say, because you believe in competition, patents are always very bad. In fact, they are complementary. And they are complementary for the following reason. I innovate to escape competition, but I want to make sure that if I manage to escape competition, I get temporary rents from my innovation. That's what patents will give me. So patents and competition are complementary. They are not mutually exclusive. They believe that if you believe in competition, you should not have patents. Other people before them, like Bill Gates, believe that because you believe in patents, you should not have competition. But they have in common that they believe that one implies the opposite of the other. In fact, they are complementary. So that's a debate that, you know, in economics that we can have. I know if I'm too long, if in 2 hours, tell me that I've passed my time or I'm still have, yeah. Another debate is the competition policy goes against any form of industrial policy. So that's an interesting way, is that in a sense you say, well, we believe in competition. We know that this implies you don't want the old industrial policy. But does it mean that you want no sectoral policy? So for example, Brussels, whenever you have state subsidy to a sector, they say, no, stop doing this. Is that right or not? And I argue that it's not right. You don't want to select firms, But you may want to select sometime, to some extent, you know, you may think that renewable energy is important. You may think that, biotech for health is important. You may think that some form of it can be important, but you can do it in a competitive way. You can say, I select a broad sector, and I make sure that I maintain the sector competitive. So I treat everybody the same, and I maintain competition. So nothing prevents sectoral policy from being pro-competition. Okay, so that's an idea I will get back to. But just to see that you can have already there interesting policy debates, you see, and on how you conduct. So that was the competition policy. Let me go a bit faster now So the second thing that I look at is education and universities. So it's very, I know already that it's good to have good PISA tests, and that's good always. But having well-ranked universities is very more growth-enhancing, closer to technological frontier. So here, it's a growth across US states. So the to the left is the, when I have states at frontier, those are the frontier of productivity. So it's Massachusetts, California is the most advanced state, but those are the advanced states in the US. When you are in those states, growth is very much boosted by research education. When you are in Alabama or Mississippi, it's more two-year college education, up to two-year college that's important. And what you have cross U.S. state, so that's the thing. But the more advanced you are, the more growth is boosted by research education. So that's very important. In France, so in Germany, they understood that for Switzerland has been the leader. In fact, when I looked, because the French government asked me to advise on universities, and I didn't want to come just with say U.S., and I realized that I didn't know that Switzerland was so good. You are very good, you know. You knew that you were very good? That you have a PISA. If you look at, Shanghai per habitant, you are top of the top of the top. You are top 50. You are the only top 50 country in Europe. Yeah. Even Sweden, all those guys, they come at top 100, but not top 50. So Switzerland is doing extremely well. France is terrible, but I always said France, you know, there is always something. There is worse, there is Italy, who is doing worse than France. But nowadays, it will not last, because now they're doing with France. It's no longer true. Soon it will change, because they have a very dynamic leader in Italy now, which I hope will wake our own a bit up. You need to spend more in education, but you also need good governance of a university, and I will say a bit more later. Okay, so that's the higher education, very important. One thing we show here is that it's not only you want more spending, you want more autonomy. It's very important to have autonomous universities. They can decide themselves to hire and fire. They can decide themselves about the budget. They can decide themselves, about lab equipment, etc. That's very important. It's not only you want them to be well-funded, you want them to be more autonomous so that they can really compete for good faculty, for good students, for good equipment, etc. Okay, so the third pillar is labor market flexibility. Similarly, you can show that labor market flexibility is more growth enhancing the closer you are to frontier, because when you innovate, you need workers to work with the new technology. And that's what labor market flexibility will give you, okay? I don't want to go and the last one is finance. So finance is that a country moves closer to frontier, you need more equity financing. Why? Because innovative investments are more risky, and therefore investors require both to get a share of upside returns and to get control rights. And that's what equity does for you, you see? That's the reason why equity is. And here is work done by a colleague at UQAM, Université du Québec à Montréal, that shows that the closer you are to frontier, the faster you grow when you have market-based finance, whereas when you are bank-based finance, you do worse when you are closer to frontier. You see, so that's a similar. You want to organize your financial system differently. So those are the kind of policies that you want, okay? And now the question is that, you know, given that, how you rethink, by the way, this table, I won't go into this table, but what this table says in one word, it says that you could regress growth on ICT. The better doing country in Europe or worldwide were those who did more ICT, who diffused information communication technology the best. But once you control for higher education, labor market flexibility, and product market flexibility, the ICT coefficient becomes significant. Behind the ICT is the elements that I talked about. You see, ICT is just a reflection. Well, those who are really good, it allows them in particular to diffuse ICT more and more quickly. You see what I mean? So the ICT thing hides, but I will get back to the wave because I want to say something about the technological wave. But it's very interesting that the fact that you seem, oh God, you know, to grow fast, you need to diffuse ICT better. You said, well, what do you need for that? You need the ingredients that I talked about, okay? So now let me talk about the role of the state. Why do we need the state? What can I answer to the Tea Party in the US? So if you want to answer the Tea Party, will you answer, of course, you will not tell them keep the old welfare state, because then you are dead born, okay? So that doesn't fly. So you need something else. Why do you need the role of the state? Because you have two reasons. There is what we call knowledge externalities. For example, if I invest in education, I don't internalize the externality this will have on my children fully, on people who work with me, and the growth externalities I will generate. I look at my salary, how it will increase. But that's just one part. I'm not looking at the other part. Firms, when they make some investments, they don't internalize the externality that those investments can have on the knowledge of other firms. So typically, that's because you have those externalities, already that's a reason for the state to come in. You see what I mean? So I will give you an example of these externalities in terms of climate. Firms, you know, that innovate clean, they don't internalize the fact that this will push more firms in the future to innovate green and clean. And that's why you may want the state to redirect technical change towards clean innovation. You see what I mean? So this argument is very strong. There are many instances that for what you need the state is because there are these knowledge externalities, these growth externalities that are playing in. But those are magnified by credit constraints. There are people who would like to go to school, but they can't afford it. For example, we know now that in the US, a big problem, Goldin and Katz have written a book on that, is that you know, tuition at universities in the US are becoming higher and higher. But people have credit constraints. They cannot borrow as easily as they could in the bank, okay? And therefore, they cannot go to universities. And that's a big problem. So that magnifies. So either the private individual does not internalize the knowledge externality, or if he does, he may face credit constraints that, you know, inhibits its ability to do the growth-enhancing investment. So those are the things that the Tea Party people ignore. There is no knowledge externality in their world. There is no credit constraint in their world, okay? And we'll get back to that later on. It's a recurrent thing. How long do I have? 20 minutes? I think I should speed up a little bit. What do you think? So, okay. So let me just say something on investment. So we know we need a state, okay? Now, what does it mean, a smart state? A smart state is a state first that it doesn't do what the Keynesian would say, spend everywhere, what the kind of, I would say, called primitive Keynesian, because Keynes was much smarter than what we, you know, people tell him that he was saying. He was much smarter. But the idea is that you have to be selective. You have to select in growth-enhancing investment. So you go universities, education, some useful infrastructure, some useful sectoral policy, R&D equipment. The state has to be selective. You have to select your investment. So that's first thing. So now the target, we call that targeting of investment. The targeting can be what I call horizontal. It means I help R&D everywhere. I help education everywhere. You see what I mean? It can be also vertical. I may consider that biotech is important. I may consider that renewable energy is important. So you have to target your investment. That's the first idea. The second idea is that you need good governance. It's not enough to invest more. You have to invest better. And that's a very important thing. You see, here is an example. I will take three examples: schools and universities, industrial policy, and macroeconomic policy. Schools and universities. Here is a cross-country regression by Wossmann and Hanushek. About growth, on the vertical axis you have growth rate, on the horizontal you have PISA tests, the test scores, okay, at the PISA. Countries that have better PISA tests grow faster. So it's important to have good PISA tests. That's why the PISA is so important. So the quality matters. If I had just regressed, you know, growth on the number of years at school or on the quantity of money put in schooling, I have almost a flat. So what matters is not just to spend more, it's to spend better. For example, Finland and France, they spend the same amount, the same fraction of GDP in education. But Finland does very well because they focus on tutorship and quality of teachers, whereas the French, they focus on the foulard, on the scarf, they focus on, you know, whether you teach a boy that is not a girl, la théorie des genres, whether you have 4.5 days a week instead of 4 3/4 a day a week of schooling. There is, you know, weather, whatever. You see what I mean? Not the important things. Well, but my day they make become intelligent. You know, I don't think they're very stupid all their life. Okay. But the universities is the same thing. Of course, we spend more in universities, it's better. But what I showed is that autonomy is also important. You want well-governed universities. And I tried to explain in France, how could you import the Swiss model in France for universities? You see, if I could have Zurich everywhere in France, I would be extremely happy. We would be done. You see, but it's very hard to get there, I can tell you. But that would be good. So you did good governance. My second thing is industrial policy. I told you before, we don't want the old-fashioned industrial policy. You want a pro-competition, good selection criteria. You select sectors with growth potential, and you have objective criteria. You want competition, you want to reconcile sectoral policy and competition by letting anybody go into the sector, and you want good exit mechanism. If you realize that your investment was not good, you need good exit mechanism. One good one is private-public partnership, because if the private side leaves, you can say, well, you know, it was not good and I leave. You see what I mean? So there are ways to organize, to govern sectoral policy. And so the idea is not just should you have it or not have it, it's how you should govern it. And that's something that the Keynesians don't do. Okay, and the last one is the macroeconomic policy. There again, you have two views. You have the old Keynesian, the Krugman, Stiglitz, Summers, who say just spend and that's it, okay? Then you have the conservative view, the Tea Party said just, you know, minimize spending and don't make any investment and don't intervene at all, the no state. So the one is the old welfare state view, and one is applied to the business cycle, the Tea Party view is just, you know, don't do anything. But we know that that's not good because you have knowledge externalities and credit constraints. So again, those guys come in, and when those guys come in, you say, look, when those guys come in, if you say, you know, you want, in fact, something which is neither the Keynesian nor the conservative, you say, look, firms, they need to maintain R&D over the cycle. Why? Because it's good for growth in general, not for the firm alone, for everybody. But firms are credit constrained typically. So how much R&D they can put is a multi, you know, depends on how much cash flow they generate. But in a recession, the cash flow goes down. So typically a firm that's credit constrained in a recession has to cut on the R&D. And we see that more credit constrained firms have more pro-cyclical R&D. So then you need the state to compensate for the imperfection of the credit market. You need the state to come in to help firms maintain R&D. How can the firm can do that? For example, to say we have a small business act, we maintain subsidies over the cycle. Another way is to say I lower interest rate in recession and I increase interest rate in expansion phase. So we have the monetary policy, which is the interest rate, or to say I maintain some expenses to help firms over the cycle. That's the fiscal policy. And that's what is counter-cyclical. You make fiscal easier and monetary easier on firms during recession to make up during expansion. You remember we have the notion of you have automatic stabilizers in Switzerland, of course, but they apply to consumption a lot. The idea there is to say they should be there for consumption. That's what we keep from Keynes. But they should be there also for firms. There are a number of support to firms, R&D and training that should also be maintained constant over the cycle. And that's the idea of the third way. It's neither Keynesian because it's not that you just boost demand. You are looking at long-run growth and you are looking at the supply side, nor is it Tea Party because you say the state intervene, and the state intervene like this. And in fact, you see, the idea is that more counter-cyclical policies, when you are more credit-constrained, is more growth-enhancing because it allows you more to help firms maintain R&D investment. And that's a very important thing. here I look at the counter-cyclicality. So when you have a high thing, for example, so I think it's Denmark and Denmark and Sweden. They are very highly counter-cyclical. Germany is not, Finland is okay, and this is Greece and Italy, and they are very pro-cyclical, okay? And you want people to be more counter-cyclical. And it's very interesting that that one thing which is very interesting is one way to become more counter-cyclical is to have lower budget deficit. When you have lower public debt and lower deficit, it's easier to be more counter-cyclical. Why? Because it's easier to borrow for the state in recession to reimburse in expansion. You can do that at a lower rate. So that's what, for example, Anders Borg in Sweden has understood. It's not just that you have to reduce public deficit to please Brussels or to please Mrs. Merkel. It's because you please yourself. You allow yourself to conduct more counter-cyclical fiscal policy or monetary policy. And that, I think, is a very important finding from this. Okay? So I don't want to show you table. The table says exactly that the more credit constrained you are, the more growth enhancing it is to have more counter-cyclical fiscal, but it will be the same for monetary policy. So conclusion one, where are we so far? Okay, so far, transition from imitation to innovation-based growth requires to promote competition and turnover, to promote labor market flexibility and training, to invest more and better in higher education, and to have more supply-side and macroeconomic policy over the cycle. Here it's written microeconomic, no, it's written microeconomic. Okay, so that's what you... So the second conclusion is that these policies, you know, you have to... it requires a new role of the state. In fact, the state has to achieve a magical triangle. And each of the sides of the triangle helps the other two. You want, ideally, to have growth, reduction in public debt, and social mobility. Each of them helps the other one. If you have low public debt, we saw that it's easier to have counter-cyclical policy, which is good for growth. If you have mobility, social mobility and mobility in general, it's good for growth as well. But if you have high growth, it's easier, of course, to finance the policies that will allow you to have, you know, the social mobility and to reduce your public debt. You see, so each of the triangle helps the other two. That's what you want to do. You want to have growth and innovation. You want to have, you know, control on your public debt and reduction of your deficit. And you want to have inclusiveness, you know, the social mobility element. So what do you do for that? Well, you should reform the state. So I try to explain Hollande that, you know, you can, it's not enough. It will not do the job of reducing the public debt in France by raising taxes like crazy. I mean, he may have to raise taxes temporarily because, you know, structural reforms take a certain time before they give. But he has also to reduce spending, to do what the Canadians did. You've done that in Switzerland, what the Canadians did, to have the rationalization of spending. I guess you did, no? But, you know, Sweden did it. Canada did it. Australia did it. Netherlands did it. France should do it, you know, to put, you say, okay, there are a number of spending that were useful before, are no longer useful because you have the technology and computers and all that. We have to reconsider the spending. So you have to reform the state. That would allow you to have money so that you can reconcile, you can at the same time reduce the deficit, and you still have some money, some savings to make investment. Of course, the investment you will do are targeted, and you will do them in a way that you improve governance so that you make sure that the money you spend is well spent. That's the smart state. Okay, you have a good balance, you have a good mastering of public deficits so that you can reconcile, you know, growth and reduction of public deficit, and you make sure that your investments are targeted and well governed. And that's what we have so far. I wanted to say, well, how long do I have? Minus how much?
9 minutes.
I have minus nine? Plus nine. Ah, that's good. No, but that's okay. Yeah. That's okay. So I wanted to say something about Schumpeter and waves, because it's a bit, you know, fun to talk about that. We think I do about Schumpeter, by the way. So that's drawn from work that friends of mine have done, okay? But I think it's very interesting. They look at productivity over the period 1890-2012 for advanced countries. Okay, and you see, they look at both the labor productivity measure and the total factor productivity. And first, the first thing that you can see, if you look at the US, you see two waves. So the wave of the 40s, that was linked to electric revolution and chemistry revolution. And we'll go in more detail. And this one is the computer, the ICT revolution. You see, you have the waves. So the waves, you know, what we call a wave is you have what we call a general purpose technology, which is a technology that you diffuse everywhere. Steam engine was a general purpose technology. Okay, electricity was one that you implement everywhere, and computers is one that you implement everywhere, and that allows you to become more productive everywhere. And you see, you have those waves. You see, that's an interesting thing. That's what happened. Now you have an interesting. So those are the two waves, and the first wave is the electricity, the internal combustion engine, chemistry, communication. That's what Gordon says. But it may also be organizational change and financial development, and that's what you have. The second wave is ICT, and there is a whole debate: did it end or not yet, etc. So that's the first thing. The second thing is that there is delay. US was first. But then comes other countries. Oh, don't look those who are higher, not higher. Japan, you see that US is there. The US is the dotted. Don't look at the magnitude, because that doesn't mean anything on this graph. What matters is really where the peak are. So this is the US. They are first. And the euro area is very much behind. And France within the euro area is still behind. You see? So that was the first wave. And now is the second wave. And what you can see is that you don't see the euro area as a whole. You see, some countries in the euro area are taking advantage of the ICT, but overall they have not yet. So the US is already on the downside of the first ICT revolution, whereas the euro area still has to get up. And why do they get up? Because they have snails that, like France, you know, that are there, you know, dragging back the thing, and other countries, you know. So that's an interesting thing. And I could show you. You see, that's the euro area. You see, that those are the two. Those are the two. The UK is doing a bit better than the average, okay? And you see the others are delayed. So now if I push a bit more, you can see, you see that the US is here, but the euro area is not yet really having the thing. So that's the UK a little bit, but not the euro area. So, for example, here is US and France. You see, and France is behind the US clearly. So that's interesting. The first productivity growth rate, you see, hit the euro area, Japan and UK only after World War II. Now you could say there was the excuse of the war. I mean, after all, you know, I mean, but the second productivity growth wave, we don't have the excuse of the war, and we are still behind. So it's absent so far in the euro area and Japan. And what's interesting is that you can ask yourself, why is it that some countries are slower getting on the wave? And we go back to the structural reforms that I mentioned before. You see, what's very interesting is that you can look at countries in particular. So maybe you won't see any difference there. But this is Sweden. And maybe you won't see that very well here. But what you see is after 1990, Sweden did a big reform of the state. Exactly what I told you. They reduced spending and taxes in 1990. They liberalized further product and labor market. Okay? They did the reform. What happened is that growth is accelerating after the early 90s. Okay? That's what happens. And you can see that even more clearly here. There is really a boosting of growth in Sweden, okay? And whereas Japan, who has not done that, you see Japan is still slow. You see, so Japan has not caught up with the wave. And what you can look at the wave, if you look at the Swedish wave, which I don't have here, you can see that after the reforms of 1990, the wave is like a train. And Sweden gets on the train with the wave. And you remember when I showed you the picture where I said, you know, ICT leaks seems to be the source of growth, but once you control for education and the various structural reforms, the wave, the ICT becomes significant. It speaks to this. It's the mirror of what you have here, okay? And so, in fact, the big guys, you know, that we always mention are the Netherlands. Growth accelerates from 0.5% to 1.5. Canada, growth accelerates from 0.3 before 1990 to 1.1. Australia, the same. Sweden, even more dramatically. You see, some people proposed in France to do the opposite of Sweden. At the beginning of Hollande, I have some colleagues that I won't name, because I never want to say bad things about my colleagues, only nice things. So when I have to criticize them in the lecture like this, I will not name them. They propose that France does exactly the opposite of Sweden. You see what I mean? They do 1990 reform in reverse. Quoi. But you see the result, what it would be. So the conclusion is that the waves, you have leader and followers, and the structural reforms help the diffusion. I would like to end up with the following thing. We've talked about what kind of policies are good for initiating innovation. We talk about the smart state in terms of nation state, okay? And we say that the idea that the state is necessary because of knowledge externality and credit constraint, but you need to be selective, good governance, and reduction of public deficit. But now you can say, what about Europe? What should we say about Europe? Well, Europe is sick these days. Why? Because Europe now, the center is no longer in Brussels, it's in Berlin. It's there that Europe is decided. Why? Because Germany is alone. Before, there used to be at least a tandem between France and Germany that would be the engine of Europe. You see what I mean? Now, Germany is alone. Mrs. Merkel is alone. And I try to say, well, why is she alone? I think because, maybe because some people in Germany maybe want to be without Europe, you see? And some people say, we want the German Europe. Would Germany want a German Europe? You see, that's a big question, of course. But I believe that Germany will want a German Europe even more if other countries do the effort that they should be doing. For example, if France does the structural reforms that I mentioned, not only it would be good for France, but the France can have an additional gain, which is that it will induce trust with Germany. In a sense, Germany, they went through hardship. You know, Schröder, the Schröder reform were hard reforms. They did a lot of sacrifices. The cost of reunification was a high cost. They want France to be to make effort. They see themselves with France like the ant and the grasshopper. They think they are the ant, A-N-T, and France is the grasshopper. La cigale et la fourmi. Ils sont la fourmi et nous on est la cigale. They want to see more happening on France. So my view is to say, look, and that's what I try to convey to Hollande, say, look, do the structural reform already because you need to do them anyway. But in addition, you have an extra. What will you get in exchange? In exchange for the structural reform, you will get a voice in Europe. You will be listened to. People will respect you. Instead of talking about the scooter and about Julie Gayet only, they will talk also about the structural reforms. So you will have a voice in Europe. And when you have a voice in Europe, you can ask, you know, for things that would ease the macroeconomy. It's true that we would like Germany to do a bit more inflation. We would like them not to oppose the union's demand for a bit higher wages, okay? We would like them also, you know, the deficit objective, you know, the fiscal compact is expressed in nominal terms, you know that. Why don't you adjust it for growth? When you have very low growth, you should relax the thing. That's the way to have a counter-cyclical policy. Remember, I told you, it's important to have a counter-cyclical fiscal policy. So you would like Germany to agree to have, you know, fiscal objective corrected for the business cycle, that in structural terms, not in nominal terms. But Germany, you would like also the ECB to be even more quantity easing in recession to compensate for expansion, like the Fed in the US is, okay? But Germany will not do anything if Germany doesn't see that France, starting from, we'll give the good example, to do structural reform. That's what I call the growth pact in Europe. You have 1 minute, 1 minute left. So that I think, so remember, I told you the structural reform, but I think the structural reform will also allow you to have more counter-cyclical macro policy at the level of the whole Europe. And that, I think, is the way. And remember, some people say, you see, there is a fallacy, and I want to end up with this. Whenever we talk structural reforms, someone like Krugman would tell you, that's austerity. No, it's not austerity. It's structural reforms. It's not that you don't spend. It's you rationalize your spending. And because you rationalize your spending, you can have more counter-cyclical policy. So when you reason in those terms, it's not that you have structural reforms versus, you know, and that's equal austerity. No, there is a way to do structural reforms that will allow more counter-cyclicality, and so you are not in the debate between austerity versus no austerity. The debate goes well beyond the debate on austerity. So their view is that whenever you do structural reforms and you don't do pure launching demand and public spending, you do austerity. But that's not the way. Smart state is something else than austerity. And that's what I hope that to convince you during this lecture. So thank you very much. I should say, oh, for questions.
So thank you very much, Philippe, for this great lecture. We have now time for a few questions. So please, don't be shy. We have a few minutes for... There is one there, Thorsten.
Yes, thank you very much for this great presentation. I have one simple question. Recently, Switzerland had an important vote on immigration, or mass immigration, as they called it. So how does this fit into your innovation story, the limitation of immigration?
I don't want to enter into internal politics, the debates, but obviously, so I think I should... I don't want to make a judgment on something decided in Switzerland. I think I should not. What I can tell you is that what is true is that immigration is an issue everywhere. How to deal with it. So the left in France, for example, used to have a policy that says, you know, let's just ignore the problem. And don't bother with the problem. And that was an issue also, to be honest with you, because it used like a bobo attitude, because many people of the Socialist Party in France would live in the 6th arrondissement of Paris, would not live in the suburbs of Paris. You have to say, well, how you deal with the thing. I think we need to have a policy of immigration. So the idea to say there is no problem is nothing. A thing to say no more immigration and foreigners are bad and to picture them one way or another, I don't like, of course, black chips and all that, I'm not too fond of. But you need an immigration policy. If only because you need to make sure that you treat well those who come. You see, for example, so that's why, you know, various countries like Canada, for example, you know, they have a policy. The U.S. have a green card policy. You see what I mean? You can discuss it or not. But there have been a policy. I don't know which policy is ideal. But you need a policy where you decide democratically how many, what kind of immigration you have. So you can have three types. You have the high skill, you have the labor immigration, and you have also, you want to be an asylum, political asylum you want to have, if you have some values for that. And you need to have those, you need to planify those. You need to have humanism and you need to have openness, but also Michel Rocard, who was a left-wing guy, used to say, on peut pas accueillir la misère du monde non plus. You see it? I mean, so you have to have a way to manage this. You see what I mean? And so I think you will come, every country in Europe will have to come to terms with that. But you should not do it based on hate, based on saying, you know, those guys are inferior to us, to look down at people. That's very bad. You need to just sit down and say, there is something called immigration policy, and I will have the smart state, it means also a smart immigration policy, to understand what you are seeking, what are your goals. It may be a mixture of skills, of humanitarian, because you want to see, to have asylum means that you are well-respected worldwide, and that has some gains. You may consider that's important. And you manage those objectives, and given those objectives, you decide how you design the policy. Here again, there is rule for smart state. How you should do it? I'm not here to lecture the Swiss how they should manage their policy.
Thank you very much for a very enlightening lecture. It seems to me that you... Sorry, you need a mic?
Yeah, here.
It seems to me that you put the role of the state, of course, very much in the center, but then you speak a lot about Europe too.
Yeah.
And as I happen to come from Germany, I was obviously quite interested in what he said about Germany, but what I would be really interested in is to hear your view of the European Union as an organization. Has it also the potential to be a smart state, or where would you see it? Thank you.
So I think it has a potential. So for example, with immigration policy, the number of problems in the European Union, we can start a long discussion, is that a number of things in Europe were done for the wrong reason. Competition policy was done as an integration mechanism. For example, if you are a firm in France that's dominant in France but not in Europe, you know, the commission competition gets at you because they want integration. So competition policy was done as an integration tool, like the monetary union was done because Mitterrand was afraid that Germany would become too powerful and wanted to link and have the euro, okay? So things have been done for the wrong reason. And that's what I think they've not been done right. So we should stop doing economic measures for political purpose, and therefore they are diverted, they are perverted from what they should be doing. Then you have to think about Europe. What do you want? You see, some people say that you may want the Eurozone very more integrated than they are, but maybe the rest less integrated. Okay, some people say that the rest, or you could imagine that on different subjects, You have circles that are bottom-up, that form, and can be integrated on those topics. So there's been various ideas on how you can minimize or reduce, you see, the inertia and this tendency to always reduce to the common denominator, which means that Europe has no voice on foreign policy, on many things. Can you have a group of countries in Europe that can express a voice? Can Europe be a forum where subgroup of countries could emerge and use the European institution to collectively get together and on various subjects on which they agree, express a view that pushes things forward? That would be very interesting to evolve that direction. But that goes beyond my field. I'm not a political scientist. But I think there is much room for Europe to be much smarter as a whole state, as a whole organization. Yeah, there is a...
So I have one question. So usually it's argued that growth is good because everybody is going to profit from the growth. So things trickle down and everybody gets, in the end, a higher real income. Now, recently it seems that inequality is growing in most societies, and I think one feature of the recent referendum in Switzerland also was that a lot of people thought we don't profit from the increased growth for which the free labor market would be good. Yeah. So is there also a role for the smart state in redistribution?
Yeah, absolutely. I told you the smart state should do three things. It should do innovation growth, it should do reduction of public deficit, and it should do social mobility inclusiveness. That's very important, because if you don't do that, we know growth generates inequality between the skilled and the unskilled, for example, okay? If you let inequality go very high and you let exclusion by the bottom and the top, you create hatred and you create, you know, populism. So it's very important to deal with inequality. The question is how you deal with inequality. And so first you have to say, well, there have been studies on inequality. They should also look at social mobility, because social mobility is as important as inequality, okay? So that's one thing. And the question is how you increase social mobility and deal with the main core of inequality. Of course, taxation, progressive taxation is one way, but it's not the only way. And that's where these people are wrong when they say that it's only taxation. Because the schooling system is very important. The training system to give a second chance to individuals all their life is very important. You see, those competition policy, it turns out to be very good for social mobility. So you have to seek what we call inclusive growth. Things that are good for growth and at the same time foster social mobility. Then you will minimize the chance, you know, the room for populism, left or right populism to take over. And that's very important, because if you don't do that, then you end up with populism, which we know can go anywhere, you see. And that's why I think the triangle is crucial. Because if you want sustainable growth, you need the social mobility. Otherwise, growth is unsustainable, because you may have, if only because you have violence or because you get populism that stops the growth process.
Yeah, you mentioned that the minimal state is not enough. And just, do you have any views on what the optimal size of the state should be and to what extent it should be centralized versus decentralized?
Yeah, no, I think you know, the size, it's very hard to say the size should be exactly this and not this. But I know that the state, there are things that the state should be doing that it was not doing before. So there's things that, for example, in France now, we have many layers of government in France. It's obvious that we should have less layers of government. Maybe we don't need the département anymore. You see what I mean? With the progress of a computer, we need much less layer of government. They duplicate. So there is room for eliminating layers of government, clearly. For example, when you have metropoles, you don't need département. That's obvious. But on the other hand, we know we need the state where it was not before, like unemployment policy or training policy. That's something that was not so crucial when you had imitation-based economy. That became very important when you have innovation-based economy. Like, for example, Denmark has been a pioneer in what we call flex security system. You see what I mean? Now, should it be decentralized? There are things that should be decentralized, and there are things that are better centralized. Schooling, for example, Finland gives a good example between having national curricula, but still leave some room for decentralization, but make sure that the national curricula and the monitoring of school is centralized, because otherwise you have disparities between regions. You see what I mean? And that's true for health. For example, a big problem in France is that health is becoming, the geographical inequality in health access is becoming every day bigger in France. So there is something where too much decentralization, you have to be careful that you control the inequality that it may generate. So that would tell you, I tell you just the counter effects one way or another. I don't tell you exactly where you should be, but you should take those things into account. Yeah.
So you have highlighted very convincingly that the PISA scores are very important and correlate to growth. But is there also research on what, like, the importance of mass media and the ideals conveyed in mass media have on society and the whole
thing? So there's been some work, I mean, I'm sure there are work that I don't know about, and here I have Bruno Frey is here, and Ernst maybe, and Fabrizio, you know, maybe. But I know of some work that shows that when you have more media access, better media access, usually tends to be good to reduce corruption. So at least more press freedom is good usually to reduce corruption, and corruption, reducing corruption is good for competition. When you have a lot of corruption, what it does is that incumbent firms corrupt politicians to prevent new firms from coming. When you have free press, there is less room for doing that. So that's one channel whereby the free press, another channel whereby free press is good for growth is that I told you about targeted investment. You want to make sure that the targeting does not boil down to I give money to my friends. That again, press freedom can help you to make sure that the targeting will not mean that you do these kind of things, you see? And to minimize the scope for crony that would go with the targeting. So those are instances, channels whereby freedom of press is crucial. I think they are dead.
I think freedom of press is important, and competition in that, in the media, is also important, because coming from a country that you said it's the only one that does worse than France, I can say that someone went up and up and up that way. But on this note, I think I should thank you for this great lecture again, and thank everybody for attending, and good evening.
Thanks very much. Fabrizio, you are way too kind.